So watch the right-hand side for Schwantz. Be interesting. I don't think anybody's going to... they got the start paranoia now. Nobody wants to jump the start, so hopefully we should get a nice even start.
Get set for the Austrian 500cc Grand Prix. And on pole, Kevin Schwantz for the fifth time this year. And
whoa,
got the red light, they're green and they're away.
Chandler crept a little bit, but it worked out for him. He got a bit of a, got a little bit of a run. But let's see who makes it to the first chicane. Looks like Dougie Chandler. Yep, Doug Chandler. That's Chandler and Catalora, Barros. Whoa! Maladi is straight over the chicane. Well, it's okay. You know, you made up a couple of places there, but you've got to be so careful there because you're not going to get away with it every lap, that's for sure.
I think Doohan and BD are
Beattie's right up there. The important thing, going up the hill on the first lap, that's Chandler, Catalora, Barros. Barros looks like Doohan or Beattie.
That's Doohan, it is Doohan, followed by Beattie.
Doohan, yeah, Beattie. And it looks like Maladin on the back, I think. Is that Maladin on the back of that group? No, it's Creville. Creville, and it looks like Rainey behind Creville, so he's not going to be too pleased about that.
Well, this is the settling in period, Barry. No, don't do anything too silly at this, is this early stage.
No, you have to let your tyres warm up on this place because it's very hard on the right-hand side of tyres because, as you can see, the most of the fast corners are all on the right-hand side, so the left-hand side of the tyre doesn't get too hot, and you have to be a little bit careful with it. Barros and the guy, Doohan. No, Doohan's got him.
Lap one under, out of the way.
All nicely through. Oh, yes, Preville's right over the... Whoa, dear me. I don't like this. It's John Rennie's English guy.
And boy, didn't he have a bad crash there last 2 weeks ago.
Oh, it's just... it just really annoys me when they do something so stupid as that to... it's bad enough as it is, you know, when you get chicanes, but when they do something as ridiculous as that. You see the distance, the first group have pulled out in the second lot, it's quite incredible.
Well, the Hondas weren't good the last time they went out, and I know that Beattie and particularly Mick Doohan are very disappointed. They've obviously done a bit of homework in between time.
Well, yeah, this circuit is good for top-end speed, and the Honda has always been pretty good on top-end speed, but in Spain they were saying that they didn't have the acceleration. And this circuit isn't too bad for acceleration-wise. You don't really need... Oh, he's going to have a little... No, I thought... I thought Catalora was going to try and tuck it up around Chandler. But it just shows you how Catalora had a decent practice in Spain. Then all of a sudden, he was having quite a decent race. Now, look what confidence does for you. Catalora right up the front here. And if you'd have said that 2 Grand Prix ago, you'd have thought you were mad.
Well, what's happened to Rainey coming to Salzburg? He seems to have been out of sorts on this track.
Well, yeah, apparently the bike's not... the bike's on the shut out. I'm not going to say. You just watch the pictures through as she came because it's ridiculous to have it like that. The Yamaha supposedly isn't going to be quick enough, but let's watch it behind Chandler going up the hill. It doesn't look that slow to me. It's not... now, look at that. He's out of Chandler's slipstream, so the Yamaha certainly isn't slow. With any kind of luck here, we could end up with a good race. That's Barros behind Doohan and Schwantz right behind Barros. I can't see, unless that... It keeps looking to me like Cravilli's Rainey when you see the red colour in the distance, but... Right, let's see. It looks like Creville, the back of that bunch there. Let's see if we can get a... No, it's Rainey. Rainey Creville just behind there. And that's Ito there, number 6.
Doohan in the third spot. Beattie back in fifth. Rainey in sixth.
You see, once this lot have pulled out this amount of ground on the bunch behind, then that gap, you see the first bunch to the second bunch, that gap is just going to get bigger and bigger. Once you lose that amount of ground, you just cannot make it up again. But it's good with this amount of guys up the front. If they can stay together for the first sort of 6 or 7 laps, there's every chance that it's going to stay like that for the whole race, which would be great for us. And it would be good for them as well because when you get 29 laps and you're racing really close with someone, it goes past just like it's a five-lapper.
Well, so Barros will be after a bit better luck than he had the last time, Barry.
Oh, yeah, he's willing enough to use his head a bit more. Doohan, yes, got Charlie in, not quite. And Rainey outside goes Schwantz. Oh, right, Rainey outside of Mick. I don't think so. It's a bit of a long way to go around there. Yeah, Mick having a look up the inside of Chandler.
What was the story with Barros? Why did he come off at that point when he looked at the race wrapped up there 2 weeks ago?
He locked up the front wheel. He tried to go in too quick, locked up the front wheel going into it, let the brake off and then ran really wide and then tried to lay it down to get around the corner and he just said that I'd outbrake myself going into it because he didn't realise that Schwantz had fallen off. See Mick out the slipstream of Chandler now. Yep, up into second. Oh, Schwantz down on the inside. Catalora going good. I like it when someone has a real confidence lapse and they get back into it again because it's nice. It's good for the sport. It's good for the sport in Italy. And the longer that Catalora can lead this, will then endorse to him that he can ride a 500 after all. I would say give it another couple of laps, maybe not even a couple of laps, and Mick's going to be up the front of this. Look, that's on board Rainey's bike. Now, this will give you a good idea slipstream-wise. You see the guy in front. They're not close. He's nowhere near close enough to get a slipstream, but if we get a shot like that and they're sort of 7 or 8 feet behind, you see how quick the slipstream sucks you along. All the top bikes, the Honda, the Suzuki, and the Yamaha, seem pretty evenly matched. You know, there's not one bike like Saito's bike in Japan wasn't. Oh dear, good move there by Barros, got past Chandler. Yeah, good move. Yeah, like Ito's bike, that guy there, number six, his bike in Japan was a rocket. Every time he passed Schwantz down the straight, nearly tore the decals off his cowling. Nick in the lead, that's what we like to see. It's nice, using all the roads. You see, he's right on the opposite side of the white line. Oh, dear. Yeah, if he can get a gap on Chandler and Catalora, and then Catalora gets caught by Barros and Chandler, and they all start fighting amongst themselves, it would be a great chance for Mick to make a break. I don't know how fit Mick is physically.
Well, Mick's made a bit of a break here, Barry.
Yeah, but he's got to make a lot bigger break than that. He's got to get, once he gets 3 seconds, then he's on a bit of a home run, because if these guys get stuck together, they won't catch him. This is all wishful thinking, of course, but he has nowhere near big enough of a gap at the moment.
Well, BT, I believe, is back in about seventh position. Rainey's moved up either fifth or sixth at this particular stage. He's in sixth. Yeah. So Rainey is making a slow climb up the ladder after an indifferent qualifying session.
Yeah, you see, when Rainey gets... That's Rainey on the back of the first pack there. See Rainey there, just at the back behind Chandler and Schwantz. Once he gets that close, you get such an enormous drag slipstream-wise up the hill that it helps you a great amount. You watch going up the hill, watch Rainey, if he's not quite close enough to Chandler at the moment. You see, that's what I was saying about the compromise, setting a bike up. You set it up so that it's easy to change direction on, but you suffer a little bit because it just wiggles, because it's a little bit nervous on fast corners. But it's not too bad. That's the way you have to do it to go quick.
Because there's such a flow to the circuit, a rider will be able to get into a nice groove because there's plenty of speed around the corners. It's a nice, smooth sort of circuit, isn't it?
Yeah, the only trouble is when you get to the top there where Mick's just come round, you're doing sort of 170, 180 mile an hour, and these things get a bit like gyroscopes. To get the blooming things from one side of the circuit, as soon as you get them left, then you've got to get them right. Oh, Schwantzy, nice move. Whoa, at the inside of Catalora. They want to go in a straight line, basically, and they just don't like being turned when they're going that quick. That's why you have to make the setup of the bike so it's a little bit nervous and twitchy. And the place that you'll see it is coming out the long right-hander at the bottom of the hill. Just as you start the climb up the hill, that's usually where they shake their heads. Oh! Catalora really getting them a bit tied in knots.
Sooner or later, that corner has got to claim somebody. I mean, these fellows are really testing Lady Luck a little bit.
Well, the point about it, you know, you see, that's what I was saying. Where Mick would probably have his bike set up more nervously than anybody's. When I say nervously, oh, look at this, nice slow-mo. You see, you can really see how the bikes twist and the suspension works and everything. I love the slow motion, the change of direction. It really shows you how the bike, you see the front forks work in there. You see the suspension. You see it compress on acceleration. Yeah, Mick would have his bike set up so it shakes a bit down the bottom of the hill. Does that mean it will make it easier to change direction? When I say easier to change direction, it's like riding a push bike with a couple of big heavy saddlebags on it. You can imagine what it's like leaning from left to right. Well, if you could come up with some demon little tweak that you did to the handlebars of the bike to make it so it was light to change direction, that's exactly what you do on a racing bike. That makes it nice and light. But as I say, if you watch Mick's bike coming out that long right hander at the bottom, and just as he changes direction, you'll see it start to do a little bit of a shake on the front end. It's nothing. It doesn't bother you. You can just let go of the handlebars. It doesn't do anything. It just kind of looks funny.
Well, the Suzukis are chasing Mick Doohan right now. It's the teammates there, Schwantz, Barros, Catalora, Rainey, Chandler.
That's the best thing to have when you're chasing someone is a teammate, you see, because what Sir Schwantz can do, he can slipstream Barros, get past Barros, then Barros gets a toe, now watch. Barros will get a toe on Schwantz and get past him, and then you... Oh, Creville out. You drag each other along. Oh, that'd be interesting to know what's happened there, because the Honda, motor-wise, is usually pretty reliable. And he didn't fall off it for once in a while. Yeah, it's Schwantz and Barros are in the greatest position of all, because, as I say, they can just play with one another and slipstream one another and help each other along. And that makes so much difference. You see, they're Rainey catching all the time. See, I see Barros's bike smoking a little bit.
Every time he goes around that corner, Schwantz peers over his shoulder just to see where his teammate is, or is he looking for somebody else?
Kevin's always looks around. You know, he loves a little blimp behind to see what's going on, and he always has done. It doesn't affect him. It doesn't slow him down. You know, some guys look behind, and it takes them a while to sort of get their rhythm again. But Kevin, it's always been like that. You know, he can look behind and still go just as quick. You see the little wiggle I'm talking about there? Now, you watch Barros now. If he gets close enough to Kevin Schwantz, he'll slipstream him up the hill, then get past, and if there's enough time, Kevin can slipstream him again.
Michael Beattie's in seventh position, and this was going to be a real test for him, wasn't he, getting to Europe, young Michael?
Darryl
Beattie.
Yeah, he's, this circuit, you see, it's... It wouldn't be a problem of lack of circuit knowledge around here, because it's so easy to learn. You know, it's not difficult to learn at all. So I don't know what's the score is with Darryl at the moment. You know, he's just settling down and on the learning curve, I guess, you know, and he doesn't want to fall down. Barros was a bit close to the back end of Schwantz then. Yeah, the last thing that Beattie wants to start doing is flinging it at the fence. You see, he's at the back of that group. Ito's in front of him now. And, you know, he's doing the right thing rather than go mad and sort of... and throw it away. But the only problem is Darryl is falling back too far. He's going to get dropped off by this lot.
Well, we've got a terrific race on our hands right now. Mick Doohan is in front. This is the Austrian Grand Prix for 1993. We'll be back in a moment.
Oh, wiggle.
Lap 12 of 29 of the Austrian Grand Prix. Mick Doohan is still in front. Schwantz, Barros, Rainey, Catalora, Chandler. That's the placings.
Yeah, that's the placings at the moment, but give it about another half a lap and look at Schwantz. Now, if Barros gets up close enough around here, he could maybe just do Mick on the... No, not close enough. I was thinking he might have been able to nip up the inside there. But as it stands, it's just a matter of time before you see Rainey right behind Schwantz now. It'd be interesting if, when Mick realises he can't get off and do a runner, then the easiest thing for him to do would be to drop back behind this group and just not let the leader get away, but stay third or fourth of it, because it's just so much easier work. You know, you get a slipstream up the hill, and I don't like the way Darrell's getting dropped off. Darrell Beattie's out of the hunt now. You can get him in the top four. I can't understand why, you know, where he's got bike problems or whatever. But now watch Barros, if he gets close enough to Mick to get a good slipstream. It'll also be interesting to see how quick the Yamaha is against the Suzuki. Yes, maybe right at the top, got him. Okay, Barros in the lead now. Let's have a look behind. Now you see, Rainey's been saying that the Yamaha's not quick enough, but the Yamaha's certainly sat in Schwantz's slipstream all the way up the hill there. And the Suzuki, everybody's always said how much of a rocket ship the Honda is, but the Suzuki is obviously as quick as the Honda up the hill there. Oh, yes. Rainey. Oh, just Rainey trying to get around the outside of Schwantz.
Well, we've established the pecking order now, I think, Barry, for the remainder of the race. These fellows are going to fight it out.
Well, Barros is looking around. I don't know, you know, all he's got to do is keep his brain together tonight, because he said, look, I just blew it. You know, he blew the Spanish Grand Prix. He knows, you know, it was rider error, and he was the first one to admit it. And I'm sure he will have learned his lesson. He'll be riding around tonight thinking, okay, right, whatever I do, I mustn't blow this one, even if it means finishing fourth or whatever. The back end, I don't like the way... That's the back end wriggle I was talking about, but that looks as if the start of that is being caused by tyres. That's the right hand side of the tyre. That's the tyre that wears Barros just about the top. Not quite. Yeah, the right hand side of the tyre works the hardest, and it looks like the right hand side of mixed tyres getting really pretty hot and pretty warm pretty early on.
Well, Schwantz was saying the last time they raced that the difference in tyre usage that Barros was using was probably the reason that he got away from him. And it was only because, obviously, the accident, Schwantz went on to win it. So I'm just wondering what the compounds they're using tonight.
Well, it's the only guy on Dunlops is Rainey. And what you've got to bear in mind is Michelin have to service all the top runners apart from Rainey and Catalora. So, this is going to be intriguing. They come up behind Arakaki, and he's got right out of the way like a good chap. Yeah, Dunlop can be really on the ball as far as development is concerned, because they only have to look after two riders. Whereas Michelin, you see, if they come out with something trick for one rider, say for Barros or Doohan or Schwantz, then everybody and their auntie want them, and quite rightly so, because they're signed up with them. You see the back end of mixed bike there? Right at the bottom there, and that is a very important corner in the last lap of the race that can mean a difference. See, look, Suzuki is certainly not slow, because he's not in the slipstream. He pulled out to the side there, and he's still staying with him.
Oh, let you get on with the racing, doesn't it? The Salzburgring. There's plenty of places to get by.
Yeah, it's great. It's a really good circuit. You know, now they've cleared all the barriers away from the edge, and Schwantz up inside of Rainey, not quite. Yeah, it's a nice circuit. It's a lovely place to go to. It really is one of the nicest. Nicky Lauda lives just up the road from there, and Nicky's almost certainly there watching the race today.
You once stopped a race here, didn't you?
Yeah, and got fined $20,000 and didn't pay it. Yeah, that was years ago, but it was very dangerous then, and you could accuse the organisers of everything then, apart from knowing anything about motorbike racing, but they've gone from being the worst to one of the best organisers now.
Good pictures coming out of Austria. Really classy.
This was the first place that we ever saw that curb cam, where they come through that chicane before the start and finish. That was the first time I had ever seen the camera stuck in the curb, and a lot of people, I think including us, have copied it since then.
Always gets a bit of a twitch there, doesn't he, Michael?
Yeah, it's interesting to note that the Suzuki nor the Yamaha gets a twitch there, and you see and mixed bike shakes a little bit on the left-hander as well. That's nothing to worry about. It's just the fact that the only thing that worries me is the fact that it's his bike is really, it looks like the suspension's a bit plunging quite a lot on the back end of mixed bike. If you notice going over the bumps there, the back end of Doohan's bike was going up and down quite a lot. Rainey having a go at first, the long way around the outside. Yes, he's got him. Perfecto. Rainey up in the third now. See, but Schwantz. Schwantz is okay. He's not too worried. All the time, and on a circuit like this, all the time you're that close, you haven't got a problem. Look how far they dropped Catalora back now. You know, this is just the experience of racing a 500. Catalora could keep it up mentally and physically for four or five laps, but that's when the other guys really come into their own, and that's where experience really tells. See, now it's Rainey and Schwantz close together. Let's have a look at Schwantz and Rainey going up the hill. See if Rainey can pass Schwantz in the slipstream. See, they're close together there. Still close together. Yes. Not quite, I don't think.
Well, there's a bit of a gap there between Catalora now.
Yeah, they just dropped him off, and they dropped Beattie off. So these are the players. There's going to be nobody else involved in this that I can see. I can't see Ito proving, making miracles and catching up about 3 seconds all in one go. You know, these are the ones that are going to do it. But it'll be intriguing to see Barros how he rides the race and how he uses his head, because he's not gonna throw another one away like that. You don't have one that easy and throw it away. He didn't realise he had it as easy as he did have it, but maybe Rainey. No.
Doug Chandler's gone missing, Barry. I thought he was going to go well here. The Kajiva had performed pretty well in qualifying.
Well, I think Kajiva found an awful lot more speed, and what usually happens with the Italian factories, they get a lot of speed, but they sacrifice bottom end power, and they make it a bit like a bowstring, so the old string's probably broken. Yeah, Barros is in good place now.
It's a race in two, isn't it? We've got these two of the open up a bit of a gap on Schwantz and Rainey.
So this is fine. This is fine for Schwantz to have Barros doing all the hard work and agitation with Mick, because then Schwantz can just sit back and let Barros do all the hard work and hopefully wear Mick down physically, because I can't imagine physical stamina-wise, that Mick can possibly be as fit as he was last year, you know, judging by his physical condition that he's in. You know, he can't possibly be as fit. So the play would be, now this is going to be intriguing, as they come up across the back markers, that's Bonil from France that Mick's going up behind now, number 3. Right, looking behind. Did he get out away though? We shall never know. I think he probably did. Yeah,
a nasty place to catch up with the back markers,
oh,
isn't
yeah,
it?
Oh yeah, it's always that's Mecklau. They're coming to pass now. He seems to be the one that seems to get back more than even more than Mr. Durakas nowadays. Now, when you get to the top, that's the fastest part of the circuit, right at the very top there. Absolutely. Believe it or not, going uphill, even when there was no chicanes going down the hill, the fastest part was going up the hill.
And lap 19 at 29, so pouring on the power now. And Rainey's dropped back a little bit, Barry.
Yeah, he has, but he's still with Schwantz. And when you get two people together, they can really start piling on the agony, slipstream one another like teammates could, and you can catch up. When you're not more than, say, 50 metres behind, you can make up that amount of ground. It's when the back markers can really do big favours and big disservices in this lot, because they could slow up Schwantz enough so that they just lose enough sort of contact between themselves and Doohan and Barros. And once you lose that little bit, it's just, you see, Schwantz is still close enough. There's no problem. I know it looks a long way, but it doesn't take much to catch that back. It's just when it gets to sort of another 30 metres more than that, it becomes an impossibility.
Yes. Barris has got him under pressure now. My gee, Mick's bike got a bit of a twitch up, a bad
yeah,
one.
Yeah, it's just the Honda just seems a little bit quicker right at the last little top of the hill. Now, this could be interesting. If Mick gets on the inside of him, well, you don't want to get stuck behind him around here. Oh, it's horrible when you have to go around the outside of back markers. You don't know how they're riding or anything. Oh, Barros. Whoa. Now, look, see, Schwantz, he was long, long way behind. It's a funny thing when on a fast circuit like this, as long as you keep just enough distance, you can make it up really quick. But once you lose that certain measured amount of distance, no matter how hard you try, you can forget it.
Well, he split away from Rainey at this particular stage. Maybe yeah. Rainey's just decided to go easy for a little while and see how it works out.
If Rainey doesn't get past that guy in front of him and catch up to Schwantz again, as soon as you get dropped off that much, then look how far. Yeah, Rainey's getting too far behind. You know, too far behind to... yeah, that is just about maximum you can be behind. You can't be... I would say that Rainey's out of the hunt now, unless this lot get held up pretty badly.
Well, Schwantz is up in a second. He's got past Catalora.
Yeah, coming up behind McWilliams, the English guy.
That was Barros, rather.
Yeah, Schwantz, yes, up the inside. That's the good thing about, well, I say the good thing, the thing about Schwantz and the Suzuki, he can just point it straight, and Barros is going up on the inside. Yes, got him. That's not drastic. That's nothing to worry about at the moment because Mick will get the slipstream up the hill and it's far from over yet. And Rainey's going to be going bananas to try and make up that bit of distance here. Oh, dear, somebody down. I see it in the background there. Can't tell you who it was. I know it was just that it was a white bike. You see right in the distance there, you can see it.
Well, the rider's okay. Yeah, seems to be anyway.
Yeah, that's Kees de Rakkers, the Dutchman. Oh, Barros pushing Mick out a little bit. Oh, dear.
Look at Schwantz go.
Now you see Rainey, he's doing everything he can to try and hang on, because if he can't afford to be any further back than that. That is just the limit. Once you get any further back than that, it's like a magic distance. You just can't do it from then on in.
You're watching the Austrian 500cc Grand Prix. Right now, it's Kevin Schwantz in front. We'll be back in a moment. Get your motor running. Austrian Grand Prix continues from the Salzburgring. Schwantz is in front, Doohan, Barros, Rainey, Ito and Catalora, and we're on lap 24 of 29.
Yeah, Mick made a little bit of a mistake at that bottom corner. It looks like he ran in a little bit deep and a little bit wide, and that allowed Schwantz to make a bit of a break on him. But the man to watch now is Rainey, because he's going all out to get back. He's got to make up that little bit of ground. You watch. Oh, this is a good shot. Some board Mick's bike behind Schwantz. Now they go into a left-hander here. Now watch the back end of Schwantz's bike on acceleration. And also speed-wise, let's watch. Right, down on the tank. Now he should get a slipstream from there. A little blimp, yeah.
Marvellous shot. Schwantz looked back at Mick and bang, he was going past him.
And Schwantz going to have another go. No, not quite. Maybe we've lost the pictures. No, we haven't. There they come back again. And Rainey is getting close enough. He's had a meteoric ride to make up that ground, Rainey, because he must have ridden so hard.
And they might just play in his hands a little bit here because they're coming up with some back markers, a whole gaggle of them.
Yeah, you're right. Absolutely right. And it just depends who gets the luck through this lot at the top. Now, Schwantz is just close enough to get a slipstream to get Mick at the very top of the hill. On the inside here, no, around the outside he's going to go. Right, now, going down into this long right-hander, I reckon Schwantz up the inside there. Right. And on the last lap, if Mick leads at the top there, that's what Schwantz is going to do on the last lap. Oh, now this can be crucial for Mick. This is... Oh, I'm going to be on his Christmas card list here, aren't I?
Well, you don't need traffic, GT, do you?
Well, you definitely don't there, but it's no one's fault. It's just a luck of the draw. But he got held up badly there. And he's got to get these guys here. Whatever happens, he's got to get past these guys here.
Oh, well, Schwartz has got the brake he needed.
Yeah, he definitely has. But Mick's not too badly off on that. He's coming up behind Rudroff. But that's quite a big lead now. Mick has got to get close enough so he can slipstream. Like, I wish once he looks behind when he's going out to the fastest part of the course. I just don't know.
He does it all the time. He's always looking for somebody who's going to all of a sudden creep up on him and take over.
Right, now this is it. Schwantz is absolutely flat straps now. You can't go any faster than Schwantz is going, because he may have been waiting to make his break three laps before the end, or two laps before the end, but that has forced him into making his break. And by the looks of it, Mick can respond to it because he's catching ground on Schwantz all the time. If you watch through here... Yeah, he's made a little bit of ground through there, Dylan. Yeah. Right. Riding good, Dylan, I tell you.
Well, Rainey's sort of ridden a strange sort of race. He's been back, he's come up, and now he's got himself into a reasonable position for some points.
Dylan's in a good place now. Good place. If he gets a good run out of this bottom right-hander, but let's just hope his tyre's not rooted so bad that it's... over the grass, that it slides all over the show, because when he comes to put the power on to get a good drive up the hill, then that's when you really need it, you haven't got it. Ah, that's not bad.
Well, he's maintained the split, hasn't he, so far, Kevin?
Yeah, but that's OK. That's all right. It's not over yet.
Yeah, three laps to go. So yeah. Mick's got to do a little bit of work.
Yeah, a lot of work, but he's certainly not out of the hunt. Definitely not. You see how much he's made up through there?
Oh, Kevin is so aware of what Mick's got underneath him right now, because he's looking around left and right.
Yeah, he's... nobody wants to win this more than... Doohan or Schwantz. So Schwantz knows that if he wins this, he's right up in season, he's leading the world championship. Right, important. Watch the two in front of Doohan and Schwantz.
Come on, Mick.
Yeah. Oh, Schwantz, has he got him? Yes, Schwantz, he's got one of them. That hasn't slowed Mick up too bad there. No, that wasn't bad. No, that wasn't drastic. Wasn't drastic there, but he's lost an awful lot of ground coming out of it somehow. I think he got stuck behind this other... You see the back end of Mick's thing just wriggling a little bit there.
Well, what he may have lacked in physical fitness hasn't really shown dramatically here tonight, has it?
No, not at all. You know, he's... that's a long way. At the moment, that is a long way. Now, you watch when we get to the top of the hill, he makes up good ground through here. See, you see all the stickers in the way. You can see the reflection, but he makes ground on Schwantz through here. You see the back end of Mick's bike just plunging a little bit. That means it's sort of going up and down. Quickest lap, Mick. 118.021.
So he's got the horsepower. It's just a matter of getting close enough.
He's got the horsepower and the willpower. You know, it's just a matter of really of Schwantz just maybe getting stuck behind the back marker in a little way, somewhere or another, just to give Mick enough chance. Well, this is okay. Nothing's going to screw anybody up, but this is the last lap. Now, tall order. Oh, you made an enormous amount of ground on the brakes there, Doohan. Whoa, God, my son. If he can get a good slipstream up the hill, this is going to be a real nail biter. Let's have a look at the front on zoom. That's Barros going around the outside. Come on.
Followed by Rainey, but we want to get to the front.
Dear me. Oh, just miss all the... Oh, dear me, that's Rainey out in the dirt. Well, come on, look, we're missing all the decent bit up the front here. No, it's still Schwantz in the lead now.
Mick just needs a little bit of luck.
No, no chance.
No, Kevin's got a nice slide through.
No, he's got that guy between them. There's no way Mick can possibly get up the inside of that guy, but it's not going to do him any... No, Schwantz has got it. Good. Wouldn't it have been nice to see what went on going up there? Good ride from Schwantz, though. Great ride. Good win from Schwantz. Fantastic ride from Doohan. You've got to hand it to him. That is a gutsy ride.
Barros third and Rainey will finish fourth.
Well, the good thing about it is Doohan's back on the go again. He's obviously physically fit enough to be able to put in a performance like that, and the bike's obviously going well enough, so we can only look to greater things then.
Well, we're not quite sure where Darrell Beattie finished, but he was dropping back there midway through the race. He looked as if he had his hands full in this sort of company at this particular stage of his development in the 500s, but... good on you, Kevin Schwantz. He is such a dominant force this year. Fifth pole position, and now he's picked up another Grand Prix victory.
Have a look at this. Nice slow. Now watch the wheels of the bike when they change direction. And do you see that back marker there? Even though he's between Mick and Kevin, it was all over by the shouting then, because Mick wouldn't have had the power enough to... Oh, nice, long wheel. Wouldn't have had enough power to outgun... Schwantz to the line, and you know, it was just a very, very good race, really excellent race.
I think Mick Doohan, by the look of that, he's absolutely tickled.
He'd have to be happy. You've got to be happy when you've been through what he's been through, come out the other side of it and put in a performance like that, then you know, I think that's great.
Oh, Wayne Gardner, you really did start something. Here goes Kevin Schwantz.
Get a silent. If that's still wet, you could really make a muck-up on that wet grass.
He's got the stars and stripes, and nobody carries it better than Kevin Schwantz. He's a real larrikin. OK, the Austrian Grand Prix has been run and won. We'll be back with all the info right after this. Welcome back to the Austrian Grand Prix. Mick Doohan, a happy man.
Yeah, that chap down there, you see the chap just to the right of Mick, that's Mick with the hat on. That guy at the bottom of the frame of the picture, that's Claudio Costa. He's the guy that basically saved Mick's leg, you know, and they're trying to get, you see there, Kevin's telling him to come up on the rostrum. But knowing Claudio, he's such a shy person, you know, he's one of the best orthopaedic surgeons in the world. And knowing Claudio, he won't have any part of it. But he's a fantastic bloke, you know, Mick really owes him his leg, you know. So I bet Claudio Costa is more pleased than anybody. Great ride for Schwantz, though, really deserved it.
And Rainey got up there and knocked over Barros just in that last leg, and that's a good result for him because he did a bit of a struggle.
Yeah, it's well, as it stands now, you know, if Barros could have beaten Rainey, then it would have been even better for Schwantz. But look at Mick, you know, that's the first time he's looked such a happy chappy for a long while.
Yeah, nice little confidence booster for him, isn't it?
Oh, great, yeah. You know, when you go through all that stuff and it starts to go right, and it's so nice to get on the podium again, especially when they look like that.
Really. He's a great character, the man in the middle, there's no doubt about that, and he is riding so well. He's riding very, very smartly these days.
Well, he is now. He's got it all together. He uses his head. He knows to ride within the limitations of the bike instead of compensating for them, but he's going great.
Well done, Kevin Schwantz. Great character, great champion. The 500cc's for the Austrian Grand Prix. Yeah, Kevin Schwantz right now is on 25 points. Mick Doohan got 20, Rainey 16, and Barros has got 13. Catalora with a Yamaha 11, Ito 10, Beattie on 9, finished 7th, and then Matt Maladin there.
Oh, Matt Maladin did actually finish then. It's the Riders' Championship now. Schwantz 111, Rainey 106, Beattie 68, Doohan 55, Creville 48, and Alex Barros 43. And Barros would have been a lot higher up if he hadn't fallen off.
He's been reminded about that for a while. Yeah. OK, now we believe that you've got a picture that you're going to show us tonight, Barry. What sort of a picture before we bring it up?
Well, it's not a naughty picture, are they? You know, I'm always talking about Jean-Philippe Rougier, the French guy, that actually rides around and he drags his elbow on the ground. And I'm always saying he's the only bloke I've ever seen in the world drag his elbow on the ground. Well, a mate of mine that's a photographer
sent me a picture of a chap on a 125. You have a look at this. This
is amazing.
Yeah, John Innes sent the photograph to me, and this guy's riding at Wanneroo, and Glenn Richards at Wanneroo. To do that on a 125, I mean, that is very, very difficult because he's a big guy, and you look how tiny the bike looks against him, but...